अच्छा था। मैं तो मैं अंदर से मार। रोल नंबर 47, रोल नंबर 47 इधर, 47, ओके। व्हाट आर द स्ट्रक्चर्स व्हिच फॉर्म्स द एक्सटर्नल नोज, नोज एनाटॉमी ओवर, स्ट्रक्चर्स व्हिच फॉर्म्स द एक्सटर्नल नोज। इट आर टुडेस क्लास इज डिसीजेस ऑफ एक्सटर्नल नोज एंड नेसल वेस्टिब्यूल। Forty-seven, roll number. Roll number 60. 60. Roll number 97. Roll number 10. Roll number 26. Yeah, what are the structures which forms the external nose?
It is made up of one third of the nose is made up of bony part and two okay. third by the cartilage.
Okay.
Cartilage is by alar cartilage. Nasal septum, septal cartilage.
No. Septal cartilage forms the septum, nasal septum. So it is in the center of the nasal cavity, which divides the nasal cavity to right and left side. Okay. So I am asking the structures which forms the external nose, not the inside the nose.
Alar cartilage.
Yeah.
Superior lateral cartilage.
Upper lateral cartilage, lower lateral cartilage.
Lower lateral cartilage.
Upper lateral, lower lateral, and sesamoid cartilage.
Columella.
Columella. What is columella?
This medial.
Medial crura of the alar cartilage.
Medial crura of alar cartilage forms the joints and forms the columella.
Columella. So what is vestibule? Vestibule of the nose. So today's topic is diseases of external nose and the nasal vestibule.
It's an airway, sir.
Airway? No. Entire nasal cavity is an airway.
Opening of nose.
Opening of nose is nares, the vestibule. Today's topic is diseases of external nose and the nasal vestibule. What is vestibule? Chanakya?
Yes, sir.
Any idea about the vestibule? What is vestibule of the nose?
Sir, anterior and inferior part of the nasal cavity is called vestibule, sir.
anterior and inferior, anterior part, not inferior.
Yes, sir.
So if you see the opening, anterior opening of the nasal cavity, that is nares. So once you enter into the nasal cavity, the anterior most part of the nasal cavity is lined by the skin. The rest of the nasal cavity is lined by the nasal mucosa. Okay.
So yes, sir.
Skin lined portion of the nasal cavity is called the vestibule. Okay. Skin lined portion of the nasal cavity is vestibule.
Yes, sir.
But today's topic is diseases of the external nose and the nasal vestibule. The external nose is formed by the bones and the upper lower lateral cartilage, sesamoid cartilage, and this cartilage and bony framework is covered by the skin. Okay? Skin and muscle. So today's topic is first to discuss about the diseases of the external nose, then diseases of the nasal vestibule. So external nose is covered by the skin. So if there is any infection of the skin and subcutaneous tissue of the external nose by the bacteria, that is called the cellulitis. So this cellulitis you can see anywhere in the body. So like that in the external nose also it may be infected by the skin and subcutaneous tissue by the bacteria, mainly by the staphylococci and the streptococci. So that leads to the red swollen in the tender nose. Okay. So if you see the clinical picture of the cellulitis, so it is very erythematous, edematous, and the tender. So they'll have the severe tenderness if it touch the nose. So it is a skin and subcutaneous tissue infection caused by the bacteria, mainly by staphylococci and streptococci. So most of the time this cellulitis of the nose, cellulitis of the external nose is from the infection from the nasal vestibule. So it is the extension of the nasal vestibulitis into the external nose, then it leads to the cellulitis. So most of the time if they are having a diabetic, uncontrolled diabetes, this leads to this kind of cellulitis of the nose. So treatment is systemic antibiotics. You have to give the antibiotics because it is caused by the bacteria, hot fomentation and the analgesics. So they'll have the severe pain, that's why you need to, for pain relief, you have to do the hot fomentation and the analgesics. And systemic antibiotics, not the local antibiotics. You have to give the IV or oral antibiotics, analgesics, and the hot fomentation to relieve the pain. So it is a skin subcutaneous tissue of the external nose caused by the bacteria, staphylococci and streptococci. Most of the time it is secondary to the vestibulitis, infection spreading from the nasal vestibule. So then second thing is nasal deformities. So if there is any trauma to the nose, then we will see the deviation of the external nose. So these deviations, so many types. So there are sadic nose or depressed nose. Second thing is the elevated nose or hump nose. Third one is the crooked nose or deviated nose. Crooked nose or deviated nose. So we'll discuss in detail what is external nose deformities. So these deformities may be because of the problem in the bone or cartilaginous part of the nose. So number one is the saddle nose or depressed nasal bridge. So bridge of the nose is connection, extension from the root of the nose to the tip of the nose. So if you see in this picture, this is the normal nose, normal shape of the nose like this. So here in this picture, this is the saddle nose. So saddle nose is nothing but this is the root of the nose, this is the tip of the nose. So this is the bridge of the nose. Connection between the root and tip, that is the bridge of the nose. It is formed by the bone and cartilage. Upper one third is the bony part, lower two third is the cartilaginous part. So most of the time this saddle nose or supraoptic depression because of the loss of support to the bridge of the nose by the cartilage, cartilaginous part of the nose, mainly by the septum, nasal septum. So if you observe here, there is an immediate immediately beyond the tip of the nose, there is a depression in the nose. That is the supratip depression or the saddle nose. Second one is the hump nose. So the bridge of the nose is elevated here. That is the hump nose. So this is the saddle nose. This is the supratip depression. This is the hump nose. So the bridge of the nose is elevated. The third one is the crooked nose. So if you see, this is the midline of the nose. So midline is maintained in the center only, but entire nose is deviated to the opposite side. So that is the crooked nose. This one is the deviated nose. So here there is a shifting of the midline to the either side, right or left side. So midline is not maintained in the deviated nose, but crooked nose, midline is maintained in the center, external nose will be deformed. So that is the difference between the crooked nose and the deviated nose. So center of the nose is deviated in the deviated nose, but in crooked nose, midline is maintained. So all these are the external nose deformities. Most of the time, these are due to the trauma, accidental trauma. So first, coming to the saddle nose, it is a depression of the nasal dorsum. So that is dorsum of the nose from the tip to the root of the nose. So it may be due to the involvement of the bony part or cartilaginous part. So the reason is, number one is the trauma, nasal trauma. And second thing is, during the surgical correction of the nasal septum, we will remove the part of the bone and cartilage of the nasal septum. So if you remove the excess cartilage from the nasal septum, then you will get the depression of the nose, nasal bridge. So that is the second reason. Third one is, if there is any infection or a hematoma of the nasal septum or septal abscess, so these will cause the pressure necrosis of the septal cartilage. Then we will see the loss of support to the nasal dorsum, and rarely by the chronic granulomatous diseases like tuberculosis, syphilis and leprosy. So these will cause the destruction of the both bony and cartilaginous part of the nasal septum. So then we'll lose the support to the nasal dorsum. Then we'll see the depressed nose or saddle nose. So treatment for this is, you have to correct the saddle nose by the surgical treatment. That is the rhinoplasty. So the name of the rhinoplasty here is augmentation rhinoplasty. You have to augment the depressed nose by the cartilage or bone or synthetic implant. Depending upon the part which is involved in the saddle nose, it is only cartilage. You have to reconstruct the cartilage by taking the cartilage graft from the nasal septum or auricle or pinna. So you have to put this cartilage graft in a single layer or multiple layer. So to give the support to the nasal dorsum. If deformity is involves the both bone and cartilage, then better to take the bone graft from the iliac crest of the same patient. So if it involves the both bone and cartilage, bone graft is better. If it involves the only cartilage, cartilaginous graft is better. That is from the either from the septum or from the auricle. So second nasal deformity is hump nose. So this is again elevation of the dorsum of the nose. It may involve the cartilage or bone or both. So it can be corrected by the reduction rhinoplasty. So here you have to reduce the elevated part of the nasal bridge by doing the reduction rhinoplasty. So all these rhinoplasties will have the open approach and closed approach. Most of the time it will be the open approach by giving the incision in the vestibule of the nose, vestibular incision. So in the columellar region, we give the inverted V-shape incision, then we will separate the skin from the cartilage and bony framework of the nose. Then we'll remove the elevated hump by the reduction by using the special instrument. Then we need to reduce the size of the nose because of the hump. So by doing the lateral osteotomies. So you have to make a osteotomy, you have to make a hole in the lateral wall, lateral sides of the both the nasal cavities. Then we should reduce the width of the nose also. So because of the hump, the nose will be widened. So you need to reduce the hump elevation, the height of the nose, and also width of the nose. Then we'll get the correct shape of the nose. That is by the osteotomies. So you have to give the vestibular incision, inverted V in the palmar region, elevate the skin and subcutaneous tissue from the bony and cartilaginous part of the external framework of the nose, reduce the bone or cartilaginous part of the nose, then do the osteotomies, then reduce the width of the nose. So that is about the hump nose. Then crooked nose and deviated nose, most of the time these two are the because of the accidental road traffic accident. So crooked nose, the midline of the dorsum of the frontonasal angle to the tip is curved in a C-shape or S-shape manner. So that is the crooked nose. Here you can see the crooked nose. So in deviated nose, the midline is straight, but deviation to one side is usually. So in crooked, these deformities are traumatic in origin. Most of the time in deviated nose, the midline is straight. The midline is straight, but the nose, entire bridge of the nose is deviated to either right or left side. In crooked nose, C-shape or S-shape external deformity, this we need to correct by doing the septorhinoplasty. So we need to correct the septum, nasal septum, at the same time external nose, nasal framework by the doing the open rhinoplasty. So same like hump nose, you need to give the vestibular incision, elevation of the skin skin from the cartilage and bone, then correction of the external framework as well as the septum. So this is about the external nasal deformities. So third thing is disease of external nose, tumors. So these tumors may be congenital or acquired. In acquired, again, benign and malignant lesions. So in congenital lesions, more in the center of the skull, there is a dermoid cyst. So origin of the congenital, if there is a defect in the bony fusion, then we'll see the dermoid cyst. Dermoid cyst, encephalocele, meningoencephalocele, and glioma are the congenital tumors of the external nose. So this is encephalocele is nothing but herniation of the brain tissue into the over the bridge of the nose or into the nasal cavity or sides of the nose. Meningoencephalocele, both like meninges along with the brain tissue. In glioma, only brain tissue without any meninges. So these are the congenital tumors of the nose. So dermoid cyst, meningoencephalocele, encephalocele, and glioma. Benign tumors, rhinophyma, hemangioma, pigmented nevus, seborrheic keratitis, neurofibroma, and sweat gland tumor. Malignant tumors like basal cell carcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, and the malignant melanoma. So like diseases of the external ear, here also all these malignancies are common. Basal cells, squamous cell, malignant melanoma. So first we'll discuss about the congenital tumors of the nose, dermoid cyst. So again in this simple dermoid and the dermoid with the connection or fistula, external opening. This is the simple dermoid. In this picture you can see. This is the simple dermoid. This is just above the nasal bone, below the skin, without any intracranial connection or extra nasal connection. This is a simple dermoid. So you can excise this tumor by giving the simple external nasal skin incision and complete excision of this dermoid. So it is a midline swelling under the skin, but in front of the nasal bones, it does not have any external opening. So that is the simple dermoid. So treatment for this is you need to excise the complete excision of the dermoid cyst. The other varieties are the with connection, with external skin connection or the sinus tract or intracranial connection. So these we'll see in the children's and the infants. So the sinus tract may lead to dermoid cyst lying under the nasal bones. So here if you observe, this dermoid cyst is below the nasal bones. There in simple dermoid, above the nasal bones. So there is a sinus tract over the bridge of the nose. So here you need to complete excision of this sinus tract along with the dermoid below the nasal bones. So in some cases, there is an intracranial extension. So sinus tract will connect this dermoid cyst intracranially. Here you can see the intracranial connection. So this connection to the cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone or foramen cica. So it is attached to the meninges. So in this case, we need to do the both intranasal and extranasal or combined approach surgeries. So we need to completely excise the dermoid cyst along with the sinus tract, which is connecting the intracranial. Third one is encephalocele or meningoencephalocele. That is about the congenital tumors. This is the this is also congenital tumor. Encephalocele or meningoencephalocele. So herniation of the brain tissue is the encephalocele. Along with the meninges, it is meningoencephalocele. So it is most of the time it is through the congenital bony defect. So an extranasal meningoencephalocele present as a subcutaneous pulsatile swelling in the midline. So the difference from the other dermoid cyst, it is a pulsatile swelling. So most of the time it is present at the root of the nose or side of the nose. If you ask the patient for the cough impulse, you can see the pulsations, pulsatile. So that is called the cough impulse positive. So and it is reducible. It may be reducible. You can reduce the tumor on compression. So it is herniation of the brain and meninges through the bony defect. It is present most of the time at the root of the nose. Treatment is surgical treatment. Glioma is only brain tissue without any meninges. So most of the time it is extranasal and the swelling is firm in consistency and subcutaneous swelling. Some of them are purely intranasal, only within the nose, and 10% are the both extranasal and the intranasal. Extranasal gliomas we can remove it by simple surgical treatment. Intranasal we need to do both intranasal surgery and that is endoscopic sinus surgery. Coming to the benign tumors of the nose, so this is important question for you. Benign tumors, rhinopyma. So it is nothing but hypertrophy of the sebaceous glands which are present in the tip of the nose. So the skin, if you see the external nose, nasal skin, upper one third it is very thin and adherent. And lower part it is very thick and it is having the number of sebaceous glands. So this is hypertrophy of the sebaceous glands which are present in the tip of the nose. So depending upon the size of the tumor, the main complaint is cosmetic appearance. So these patients will come to the doctor with the ugly appearance of the this nose, tip of the nose. So that is because of the hypertrophy of the sebaceous glands. So rhinopyma, the other name is potato tumor. They may ask as a potato tumor in the exam, theory exam. It is a slow growing benign tumor due to hypertrophy of the sebaceous glands of the tip of the nose. So often seen in cases of the long standing acne rosacea. So it presents as a pink lobulated mass over the nose with superficial vascular dilatation. So it is a lobulated mass pink with the superficial vascular dilatation. So clinical presentation is cosmetic appearance, ugly appearance. The other symptoms may be because of this mass effect, it may obscure the breathing. So if it is this lobulated mass covers the anterior nares, they will have the difficulty breathing through the nasal cavities. And it may obscure the vision also. If it is very much big, bigger than this size, then it will obscure the vision also. So treatment is complete removal by surgical method. You need to excise the complete tumor and the skin grafting. So we can use the cold instruments or CO2 laser excision followed by the skin grafting of this raw area after the excision of the complete tumor. So no medical treatment, only surgical treatment. You have to excise the tumor completely and skin graft. Malignant tumor, rarely will see malignant tumors over the external nose. Among the malignant tumors, most of the time we'll see the middle-aged people, 40 to 60 years, both males and females are equally affected. Basal cell carcinoma or the rodent ulcer, this is the most common malignant tumor involving the skin of the nose. So it may present as a cyst or papillopearly nodule or an ulcer with the rolled out edges. So it is a rodent ulcer. So it is very slow growing and remains confined to the skin for the longer duration. Treatment is surgical excision. squamous cell carcinoma or epithelioma. Second most common accounts for around 11% of the total external nose malignancies. It is also very rare. So it will be affecting with the middle-aged people 40 and 40 to 60 years. So the presentation is different here, infiltrating nodule or ulcer with the rolled out edges. Most of the time it affects the columella or the side of the nose. So in these cases, nodal metastasis will see in the 20% of cases. Then we need to excise the complete tumor along with the removal of the lymph nodes from the neck, upper deep cervical lymph nodes by the neck dissection. Melanoma is the least common variety. Clinical presentation is superficially spreading type. So it is slow growing tumor or nodular invasive type. Treatment is surgical excision. So that is about the external nose diseases. So it is, number one is infection, that is cellulitis. Cellulitis of the skin subcutaneous tissue caused by the staphylococci and the streptococci. Treatment is systemic antibiotics, hot fomentation and the analgesics. Second thing is the deformities of the external nose, both bony and cartilaginous deformities of the external nose. In this, so most of the time these deformities are secondary to the trauma or surgical treatment, iatrogenic, post-operative, post-septoplasty or SMR operation, and because of the infection, septal abscess, septal hematoma, or any chronic granulomatous infections of the septum, that is like leprosy, tuberculosis and the syphilis, will cause the necrosis of the cartilage and bone of the nasal septum. So because of these reasons, the nasal dorsum will lose the support. Then the patient will have the depressed nose or saddle nose. Saddle nose is the external nose deformity. So we need to augment the nose, that is by the augmentation rhinoplasty. Hump nose, there is elevation bridge of the nose. We need to do the reduction rhinoplasty by vestibular incision, inverted V-shape. And then we need to do the osteotomies. Then crooked nose and deviated nose also because of the trauma. So we need to correct the crooked nose, deviated nose by the septorhinoplasty. So we need to correct the nasal septum along with the external nose. Then tumors, benign tumors, congenital tumors, benign and malignant tumors. In congenital tumors, important is the dermoid cyst, meningocele, meningoencephalocele, midline swelling. These are the midline swelling. So we need to excise the tumor completely. Second one is the benign tumor. In benign tumors, important thing is the rhinopyma or the potato tumor. It is seen in the tip of the nose. The reason for this is hypertrophy of the sebaceous glands, which are present in the nasal skin, external nasal skin in the lower part. So the clinical presentation is appearance, ugly appearance of the nose, tip of the nose, and if it is the mass, because of mass effect, it may obscure the breathing, nasal airway and also vision. So then we need to go for the surgical treatment by complete excision with the skin grafting by cold instruments or the laser, CO2 laser excision followed by the skin grafting. Malignancies, basal cell carcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma and the malignant melanoma. So these very rarely you will see. Among these, basal cell carcinoma is the most common, around 87%, followed by the squamous cell carcinoma. So while local excision, if there is any lymph node metastasis, we need to go for the neck dissection also. So then coming to the diseases of the nasal vestibule. So vestibule of the nose is nothing but anterior most skin lined portion of the nasal cavity is called the vestibule. So because it is lined by the skin, here you will see the vibrissae or hair follicles. So the most common diseases which affect the vestibule are the infection of this hair follicle, root of the hair follicle or entire skin of the nasal vestibule. So that is infection, and rarely you will see the benign tumors, that is nasoalveolar cyst. So first thing is the furuncle or boil. So this is nothing but root of the hair follicle is infected by the bacteria, that is staphylococcus bacterial infection, root of the hair follicle here. This is the vestibule of the nose. So the predisposing factor for development of this vestibulitis is nasal picking. So picking of the hair follicles or plucking of the nasal vibrissae is the usual predisposing factor. So repeated cleaning of this nasal vestibular area with the fingernails, so that carries the infection, then we'll get the root of the hair follicle infection, that is the paranchylosis of bald. So treatment is analgesics, topical and systemic antibiotics and warm compresses. So rarely this paranchyl may lead to the cellulitis of this cellulitis and septal abscess. Cellulitis of the upper lip, cellulitis of the external nose and the septal abscess. So if the patient is already having immunocompromised or uncontrolled diabetes, then it will lead to the complications, that is the septal abscess and cellulitis of the external nose and the upper lip. So second infection is vestibulitis. So this is nothing but diffuse dermatitis of the entire nasal vestibular region. So again, it is two types, acute and chronic form. So the main reason for vestibulitis is trauma, discharge from the nose. So if there is any continuous discharge because of the chronic rhinitis or sinusitis or rhinosinusitis or allergic rhinitis, all these conditions will see the continuous nasal discharge along with the trauma, handkerchief trauma. If they clean the nasal discharge repeatedly by using a handkerchief, then we'll get this vestibular skin infection, that is the vestibulitis. In acute form, vestibular skin is very red, swollen and tender. In chronic form, there is an induration of the vestibular skin and painful fissures and the crusting. You can see the crusting and the fissures in the chronic vestibulitis. So this is acute vestibulitis. You can see the redness, erythema and the edema over the vestibular region. So clearly there is one-side involvement. This is because of chronic rhinitis and the trauma. So first you need to remove the disc crust by using the hydrogen peroxide soap cotton, then followed by the application of the antibiotic steroid ointment in this local application along with the systemic antibiotics and the analgesics. So if there is any diabetes, we need to rule out and control the sugar levels of the patient. Stenosis of the anterior nares. Stenosis or atresia of the nares. So if there is any accidental or surgical trauma to the nasal tip or vestibule of the nose, can lead to the web formation. Sometimes there is a destructive inflammatory lesions of the nose also because of the stenosis. Congenital atresia is a very rare condition. So if there is non-canalization of the epithelial plug within the nasal passage, then we'll see the atresia or stenosis of the nasal, this nares. Atresia is very rare. Stenosis may acquired condition because of the surgical trauma, accidental trauma and the inflammatory lesions. So stenosis or atresia we need to correct by the reconstructive surgical procedures. If there is any scar tissue, we need to excise the complete scar tissue and then we need to put some stent to maintain the nasal passage. This is the stenosis. So followed by the smallpox. Nowadays it is not seen. Smallpox, post smallpox, stenosis of the nares. Tumors in the vestibular region is very rare. Nasoalveolar cyst. It is a cystic swelling. It is arising from the root of the this upper incisor teeth and the canine teeth. So it presents as a smooth bulge in the lateral wall of the nose as well as in the nasal vestibule. So this we excise by giving the sublabial incision. Below the lip, sublabial incision, transverse incision. Then we can excise the entire cyst without any damage to the integrity of the vestibular skin. So sublabial incision, removal of the cystic cell swelling which is present in the vestibular region. Other rare benign tumor is papilloma or warts in the vestibular region. It may be single or multiple, sessile or pedunculated. Treatment is surgical excision, complete surgical excision. And rare carcinoma of the vestibule is the squamous cell carcinoma. It is also very rare, arises from the lateral wall of the vestibule and it may extend into the nasal floor or columella or upper lip. So it can metastasize to the parotid and the submandibular gland lymph nodes. So there is a chance of metastasis of this squamous cell carcinoma to the submandibular and the parotid lymph nodes. So if it involves the lymph nodes, So along with the surgical excision of the local lesion, you need to go for the complete excision of these involved lymph nodes also. So this is about the vestibular lesions. This is just of the vestibule. So mainly infection, parenchylosis or boil and the vestibulitis. If it involves the only single hair follicle, that is the parenchylosis or boil. If it involves the entire vestibular skin, that is the vestibulitis. So treatment is antibiotics, analgesics and the warm compressions. Vestibulitis acute and chronic. Acute, there is a erythema and the edema and the crusting. So we need to remove the crusting by hydrogen peroxide cotton, then application of the antibiotic steroid ointment along with the systemic antibiotics and the analgesics. The chronic vestibulitis, most of the time it is secondary to the chronic nasal discharge coupled with the handkerchief trauma. So if they clean the nose repeatedly by using the handkerchief along with the continuous nasal discharge, they'll get this chronic vestibulitis. So chronic vestibulitis, you need to control the cause for the chronic nasal discharge like allergic rhinitis. Then analgesics, antibiotic steroid ointment, topical ointment. If there is a diabetes predisposing factor, we need to control the diabetes. So tumors of the vestibular, nasalvular cyst, papilloma or warts, and squamosal carcinoma. Nasalvular cyst is there, so we need to give a subdural incision and complete excision of the nasalvular cyst. So this is about the diseases of the external nose and the nasal vestibule. Okay, next class we'll discuss about the diseases of the nasal septum. Okay, nasal septum diseases. Any doubts? Students?
No, sir.
No doubts? Okay, answer your roll calls. Roll number one. So I'm taking the attendance, I'm marking the absence, those who are not.